In this video, we are going to talk about how to choose the right chip or right integrated circuit for your new designs. You know, sometimes may happen that when you are designing boards, you may end up with multiple different options. For example, you may choose from three different processors or microcontrollers or Ethernet chips or audio chips, which are perfectly fine for what you need, but you need to pick only one of them. So which of these three processors is the one which you are going to use in your new design?
The cheapest one.
The cheapest solution may not be always the best. And that's what I would like to talk about in this video, about all the kind of different factors what you may want to consider when you will be deciding for the right chip. My name is Robert Feranek, I'm from Federal Academy, and I really hope you will find this video interesting and useful. Here it is. First, what we are going to talk about is the brand. When I was starting with hardware design, I made this mistake. I was designing a board where I needed to create some circuit. And one of the options would be use like multiple chips and a lot of components, or I could use this special chip. And this special chip was doing everything what I needed. And you can guess, this special chip was sold by a company which was quite unknown. And initially, there were no problems. When we were building prototypes, I sent email to this company, they sent us 5 samples, we built the prototypes, we tested, everything was fine, and then we decided to do the mass production. And suddenly, there was no way to buy this component, this special chip. After a couple of months, the company was poof, gone. And I had to redesign the board. Okay, since then I'm like very careful about using components or chips from not very well known chip manufacturers. When I'm looking for components what I'm going to use in my boards, I very often use components from companies like Intel or Texas Instruments, or you know, this kind of well-known brands. And when you are choosing components for your boards, you may not want to consider only brand, but also length of the component life. I learned this the hard way. When I was starting with hardware design, I focused mostly on creating schematic. I focused on designing a board which is going to work and which is going to do what we needed. I was not really thinking too much about production, or I was not really considering that we would like to keep selling this board after 5 or 10 years. And I was not really aware that some components, they have quite short life. I was not really thinking that after 1 or 2 years, some of the components may be obsolete and you may not be able to buy them. Especially for the core components, like processor or microcontroller, you really would like to be sure that you will be able to buy these components after 5 or 10 years. And you may want to go for the components with this extended life cycle. And usually, these are not the cheapest components. Okay? So, when you are choosing the right chip, you may want to consider also the life cycle of the component. My next point on this list says industrial. Do you know what I mean by industrial? It depends on what kind of product you are designing, but generally you would like to cover all the kind of different markets. And one of the big markets is industry. However, if you are designing boards for industry, then you may need to support all the kind of different temperature ranges. So when you are selecting a component for your design, ideally you would like to be sure there is an alternative of this component, or there is a variant of this component which can be used, for example, in extended temperature range or industrial temperature range. Because there are components which are only available in commercial temperature range, and maybe you don't want to use these kind of components in your designs. So, when you will be selecting your components, consider also all the kind of different temperature ranges where your product or board can be used. What else may be important? Documentation. There is a big difference in quality and also in quantity of documentation between different chip manufacturers. Some of the chip manufacturers, they provide like really poor documentation. Just a couple of months ago, I was working with my son on a project with e-paper, and a datasheet for the e-paper and datasheet for the controller, which was connected to e-paper, these documents were really bad. And it was super frustrating, and it was like very time consuming trying to find out how to make it work. When you are selecting a chip for your board, you really don't want to go into this kind of situation. You really would like to use a chip with a datasheet, which is going to describe exactly how this chip works. Datasheet, which is going to describe every single pin, which is going to describe all the registers and explain very well how these registers need to be set and what they do. And when we are talking about documentation, then it's not only about datasheets. The best the best chip manufacturers, they provide also design guides, really good design guides. You can learn a lot from design guides, and they will help you, for example, with PCB layout. A good chip manufacturer will provide you with schematic and PCB checklist. So you can just go through this checklist, you can compare them with your schematic or with your PCB, and you can see, like, is this 100 nanofarad capacitor connected to this specific pin in your schematic? Yes, it is. Checked. Okay. Is this track routed this way? Yes, it is. Checked. So, good chip manufacturer will give you all the kind of documentation which is going to help you to build your product, the product which is going to work right at the first time. And that's very important, because good documentation can save you a lot of time and a lot of money. If there are, for example, three chips which are doing exactly same thing. And you can choose from these three chips, have a look how good is documentation for each individual chip. And for your design, choose the chip which has the best documentation. Or you don't have to select the chip with the best documentation, but at least you may want to consider the quality of the documentation when you will be selecting the chip. Now, what do we have next in this list? Support. I'm not sure what is your experience with support. My experience with support is usually like not the best one. If you are like a top customer of a chip manufacturer, you will get excellent support. Yeah, you will have access to their experts and they will try to help you to solve your problems. But if you are like a normal company, most companies, they will be just like normal companies. Usually you will get the kind of support which, I don't know, refers to a text in data sheet, or they will answer something what you already knew 2 weeks ago. So it's not like super useful. Then why we are talking about this? Because there are also different kind of ways how you can get support. And one of the really great supports is community support. So if you have like three chips which are doing exactly same thing, what you may want to do, search on internet and have a look for which of these chips you can find a lot of information. Some of the chips are used also by other people. And these other people, they may try to connect this chip the same way as you are trying to connect it. And they may ask questions on forums, for example, how to solve these problems. So if there is like a lot of information on internet about how other people are trying to connect this specific chip, it can be very useful for you. And it doesn't have to be only about forum. It can be also about how many other schematic circuits or reference designs for this chip you can find on internet. Because some people, they can create open source boards and you can have a look how they use and how they connect it, this chip. And again, this can be very useful. So if you can choose a chip which has like big community support, which has a lot of information on internet, then maybe this could be something what you may want to consider when you will be selecting between different chips. We have already mentioned our next point, and it's reference boards. I always like to use chips with reference designs. Why? I'm sure you know why. There are actually more advantages, but the top reason why I like to use chip with reference designs is because I just can take this circuit. I know this circuit works and I just place it into my board. And it makes it a lot easier to design your board the way that you just take a number of reference designs from different chips and you connect them together. This way you can be quite sure that the board what you are designing is going to work. It is like much better way to design the boards rather than taking a chip and then trying to figure out what other components you need to place around this chip to make it work properly. Okay, connecting different reference designs together is much easier and it is there is much higher chance that everything is going to work. Other reasons why I like reference designs is because you can buy reference boards and you can test them. You can import these reference designs. So if you can use a chip which will have, for example, schematic available in OrCAD or Altium, so you can reuse this schematic, you can import it, and this way you kind of minimize the possibility of making mistakes when redrawing the schematic. If there is a reference design, very often you can also get information about BOM, bill of material, so you know exactly what kind of components they use, and again, this can be super useful. You can have a look at placement of the components, and you can have a look at layout. And more reference designs is available for the chip what you are going to use, that's better, because there is higher chance that one of these reference designs is going to be exactly what you need or something similar to what you need. Generally, I really like reference designs. And I almost forgot. If you can import or if you can reuse the schematic, it can save you a lot of time, especially for large projects with many schematic pages. It can be huge time saver because you don't have to redraw the schematic. You can just reuse the reference schematic. Let's have a look what we have next here in this list. Performance. There may be big differences in performance between different chips which are saying they do exactly the same thing. For example, if you have three different Ethernet chips and they are all saying they are 1 gigabit Ethernet chip, when you actually test these chips, you may find differences. And if in your board you need like top performance for Wi-Fi, then you really would like to maybe test different solutions for this Wi-Fi connection, because for example, a solution with PCI Express may have like completely different performance comparing to a solution through SDIO interface. Be aware of this, because some marketing materials and even some data sheets, they will not really point out the real performance of specific chips. So you may want to buy reference boards and actually test the performance by yourself. And we are almost finished. The last point on my list is software. Some hardware design engineers, they underestimate this point. Because, you know, you are a hardware design engineer. Your responsibility is to design hardware. Why you should care about the software? That's not your problem. That's the problem of your software engineers. However, if you have ever created some software, you know how difficult it can be to actually write software from scratch. And you know how much easier it can be if you can find an example which you can reuse. Do you know how difficult it can be, for example, write a driver for Ethernet chip? How you would be doing that? Yeah? Your task is write a driver for Ethernet chip. What you are going to do? It's like super complicated. There are only like few people in whole world who can write drivers. So even if you design super great board, and if there is no driver for Ethernet chip, first, it may take ages to write this driver, or it may not be even possible. So you really don't want to use this kind of chip on your board. really good chip manufacturer, they provide something what is called software development kit. And this software development kit will help you to write software or adjust the software to your board. And you really would like to follow what kind of support they have in this software development kit. So instead of using a super cheap Ethernet chip, maybe you would like to use the one which is supported by the software. Okay? Super important point. You can spend a lot of time on software. And if you can use the right chips which are already supported, it can be like very, very helpful and it can speed up development process of your whole product. Of course, if you are designing a board with microcontroller, then you may want to use the chips which other people normally connect with this microcontroller, and you can find examples of code on internet or on the chip manufacturer website. All these points, what we were talking about today, they mean that going for a cheap chip may not be always the best option for your designs. That's everything for today's video. Leave comments. What is important for you when you are selecting a chip for your boards? What do you think about? What do you consider? Your comment, your feedback, it can help also other people. If you like this video, don't forget press like button. If you would like to see my future videos, don't forget to subscribe. I would like to thank you very much for watching and see you next time. Bye.